is our first Marketing You, Marketing Support for Solopreneurs broadcast. And today we have here Rebecah Freeling and Stephen Auerbach, also known as Dr. Toy. And I'm going to ask a few questions of each of them to tell us about their business and find out if they've got any marketing challenges. And we'll give this first round a go. So welcome. And this will be available on YouTube afterwards. And I'm excited to give this a try. And I appreciate both of you being willing to be the first ones up.
So, thank you, Rebecca, for sharing your marketing expertise with us.
Great. So, Rebecca, tell us a little bit about your business and your background and what you're interested in growing.
I am a family coach. And I used to be a preschool teacher. And in my work with kids and families as a preschool teacher, I was particularly drawn to the kids who we call spirited, the ones that have a hard time paying attention, don't quite seem to fit into a regular program, drive their parents crazy. And when that was in Columbus, Ohio, where I had that child care center. And then when I came out here to beautiful California, I decided I wanted to work just with the parents and kids in a more concentrated way. So I've started doing this family coaching where I take parents through whatever they need to, you know, everybody kind of has their own path about where they start and where they need to end up. But I try to get them to where they're feeling really good about parenting and where they're really able to communicate with the kids and where the kids are really able to communicate their needs and manage their big feelings and big desires and big ideas.
Great. So tell me, in terms of your ideal client, and it's one or more of those kinds of kids, is that right? And are they, do they need to be geographically in the Bay Area, or can they be anywhere? I lost your, can you start over there? I lost your audio for a second.
Oh, sure. Yeah, right now all my clients are in the Bay Area, but I have also done sessions by Skype. And we're wanting to scale this work so that I don't have to be in the same room with a parent to be able to help them. There's a lot of people who need help and that aren't getting it, and I'd really like to be able to serve a lot more people than I can physically go around and meet. And mm-hmm. Yeah, it's parents who, basically parents who just, they've tried everything. They don't know what to do next. You know, these kids are getting kicked out of preschool. They're getting kicked out of first and second grade, and for no reason other than the teachers just don't have the skills to manage them. The teachers themselves are overwhelmed by the number of kids they have in their class like this, and the parents just are at their wit's end. And that's usually where they find me, at their wit's end.
How do they find you?
They find me right now through Berkeley Parents Network. I have several parents who have put recommendations for me there, and so I'm getting a lot of calls from them and word of mouth also. And I do workshops. I do Q&A workshops, and sometimes parents come to those and then decide that they want to work further with me.
Great. And what other kind of marketing in addition to Berkeley Parents Network and the workshops have you done?
We have posted flyers. That didn't go great. It was okay, but it ended up not being worth the effort. And I want to start doing radio talk shows, and we're developing a program now. We're developing an online program for parents. And when we get that developed, then we'll start marketing that program.
Great. So are there any challenges or any help that you want from either Stephen or I? It's amazing how close her area of expertise fits with yours. She might actually have a lot more value to add than I do on this one. Well,
just to ask you a question, Rebecca, have you reached the teachers who work with the parents and either helping them gain some additional skills, the kinds of things you know to do, or for them to do the referrals of the parents, you know, who are having problems with their kids?
I have a couple of preschools that I'm working with who we refer back and forth to, and I go into the classrooms and help the teachers kind of figure out what might work better for this child and help the family set up some systems that'll help the child. So I am getting into schools, so some teachers are getting to know me that way. I don't have a lot of those people yet, but each time I go into a school, I try to start a relationship with the principal there and the teachers there so that they know that I'm a resource for them.
You're really doing a very important service, because there are a lot of children out there who have these needs, and the parents really are desperate and don't know what to do.
Yeah.
So that's really, it's very useful.
So one of the challenges that we've had is that the paid marketing hasn't generated much, and so we've stopped doing that. We're not doing any paid advertising at this point. Mm-hmm. And in terms of reaching more people, I wonder what your experience is with what they call joint venturing or affiliate marketing.
Mm-hmm.
And then as we're trying to create a product that's scalable, you know, to a really, really large audience, I just wonder, you know, what experience you've had with that and what recommendations either one of you might have for that.
One of the things I think right away would be really useful is to get a series of booklets or a book created, a manual.
Uh-huh.
In which you have your original introduction, some of the things you know about to identify the problems, how to go about doing it. So it's a how-to book that you can then market and also have that as part of a resource when you do workshops, take it into schools and so on. Mm-hmm. Because you have an expertise that more parents, no matter how many you reach, they're going to be, you know, 1,000 more that need it.
Right.
And having a book behind you would be something you could speak about, different groups and organizations and so on. So that's one recommendation I right away am thinking about. Right? And it's something very easy for you to put together because you have all the expertise.
Yeah, we've been tossing around the idea of a book, and then as we read parenting books, it's like, wow, there's a million of them, and how to be strategic so they're really useful to parents. One reason parents find them unuseful is because they're not really customizable.
Sure.
And, you know, they're written for a certain type of parent or a certain type of kid, and what works for one combination of parent and kid is not going to work for another. And, you know, and I tell parents, that's why there's 10 million parenting books.
Well, I was really thinking about, like, recipes. Almost kind of a prescriptive kind of thing. To the point. Not an intellectual book that's going to be over people's heads.
Right.
But kind of this really down to earth, how to deal with a particular behavior and some suggestions or ways to deal with it. So it becomes a recipe book for success to help change children. There are not many books like that around.
Uh-huh.
I haven't seen anything that deals with the very basics of handling a difficult child. You know, just something really simple and to the point.
Uh-huh.
Kinds of things we do on a one-to-one basis with parents.
Right.
Another suggestion I have, one of the things I've been working with lately is putting some courses on a website called Udemy. And there are other sites like that. There's several I can suggest that you take a look at. But if you could package a kind of intro course, relatively low cost, that gives you a platform to leverage. And mm-hmm. the Udemy platform, one advantage they have is that they've got 5 million students already, and they're growing pretty quickly, so they're bringing in eyeballs. And it's very easy. I found it very easy to use. So that might be a possibility to look at. Is there a product, you know, to productize something? I think similar to what Stephen is saying, is there a way to come up with something that's tangible, a book, a course, a video, or a set of videos that will allow you to have an entry point for people? And you could even mm-hmm. offer it for free and have that as perhaps on your website. in exchange for their email address, they get access to whatever this thing is, and that you build your email list that way. I don't know how big your current email list is. That's one of the challenges with affiliate marketing is everyone wants to be playing with people with at least growing email lists. So I don't know if that's something you've done already.
We have on our email list, I'm going to guesstimate, is maybe 150 to 200.
Mm-hmm.
And we've gotten that. We go to preschool fairs and get parents to sign up through that. And, you know, parents that were in my preschool class when I was teaching here. And, you know, and then the current clients I have, they refer friends and I send out a newsletter like once or twice a month, and you know they'll forward it to their friends, and then their friends will sign up. So it is slowly building.
I had a question, Rebecca. Do you have some endorsements from the parents that you've assisted, so
yes,
that you can put those on the site too? That's useful.
Yeah, on my website I have testimonials from parents, and then if I see somebody requesting something in BPN for a recommendation. I have several parents who have said, yeah, just let me know, and I'm very happy to write recommendations. So we have several of those.
Okay. That's great. I mean, Berkeley Parents Network in your model is probably going to become, over time especially, a huge referral source. What I've seen happen is that the real power of it is over time as those things get posted into the various archives, not just in the first response on the email, as you probably have already seen. Have you had any yet archived on Berkeley Parents Network?
Yeah, they are.
Okay, great. Yeah, good.
I was thinking of pediatricians also, who might be helpful. Getting announcements out to them, because they don't have time to deal with some of the behavior problems, other than medications.
Right, and some of their suggestions are not not so insightful.
Just another resource that I'm thinking about. And also the California Association for the Education of Young Children has a conference. Mm-hmm. They have local chapters in San Francisco and so on. So, you know, speaking at one of those groups would be useful.
Mm-hmm. That's a good idea. They reach a lot of early childhood teachers there.
And you get referrals from them.
Mm-hmm.
And is it mostly at that early childhood stuff?
Well, that's when you start to pick up on it. When the child is acting out in kindergarten, in first grade, that you know they're having some difficulties. And that's when parents get concerned. They don't know what to do.
Right. And hopefully they're reaching out to me at that point. If they haven't, I do also work with older children. I'm working with a couple of, you know, preteens who, you know, didn't get the help they needed when they were in those preschool years. And so it's really, you know, throughout childhood, I haven't worked a lot with teenagers. And so I'm selective about the teenagers that I work with. Just because that's not where my deep expertise is. But, you know, up through that point, up through like age 12, those are the kids that I'm working with. But I do, as Steve Ann said, most of the people who call me are in the preschool years and early elementary, because that's where it really starts to show. And I get a couple of parents who are really perceptive enough to say, my 3-year-old isn't growing out of this 2-year-old thing. And they kind of see what's coming down the pike in terms of what the expectations are for school, so they'll call me at that point.
Mm-hmm. Great. Any other things you want to address before we wrap up your session?
Let me put my glasses on here to see my notes. Let's see. We talked a bit. Well, what other suggestions do you have for audience building? And I would invite your feedback about how I've described my work and the things that I've said about it, and if there are things that you think I could say better. And do you know any anybody who might be a prospective venture partner or affiliate marketing partner.
Do you have a brochure?
I have a website. I don't have a brochure. I have a business card and a website. And when I do workshops, I make flyers for those.
That would be very useful to have on the front and back, 8.5 by 11, folded in thirds, your message.
Uh-huh.
That would be a great first start. I'd like to see it, because if I can give you some feedback, that would be the first place I would start before I got to the website. If there's some key phrases that you then pick up and describe further in the website,
uh-huh,
that you can pick up on the in the book, you know, it becomes very clear what you're working on, what people, what you're looking for to do. You know, if you're a resource to teachers or you're a resource to parents, you know, to the child, improving family communications. You know, there's so many different ways to cut this. And to get right to those, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 main points that become really clear to send your message out. So I'd like to see it when you get it together.
Okay, thank you.
A couple other thoughts that come to mind. One is the whole nanny stuff on television. I forget the names of all
right,
the shows.
Right, Nanny 911.
Yeah. And I wonder what kind of social media presence those influencers have, because if you can start to interact with them online, other people on Twitter, for example, or Facebook or wherever, they interact with them and develop a Twitter relationship, you'll start to build your presence in their markets.
Right.
So you can build your influence. That good book called Unmarketing that by Scott Stratton that talks about how to use a Twitter strategy, how to develop a Twitter strategy for that purpose.
Uh-huh.
And really the key is to look for the influencers in your area, not to just try to grow randomly. So to interact with those folks. I think another possibility, in addition to the course that I mentioned earlier, be to... I think, you know, building off of the website, there's also kind of, and I don't know whether you interface with this or not, but I know someone who's got a mindfulness and program that she's been marketing, and I'm wondering whether that's a connection or whether it's too much of an overlap for you. And then I'm just going to throw out there, Kaiser has a lot of things for education for their membership. And that might be an avenue to, they've just started, for example, a wellness coaching program for members. That might be an avenue through the pediatric groups there to get access in a bigger way.
I piggyback on that by saying you might suggest to the person who does lunchtime presentations at Kaiser that they have a speakers program, and that might be a good place
to
start with. And PG&E has it. There are a number of companies that have lunchtime speakers. I've done that for many years, and it's just a great way to get your message out. But you got to have your brochure first. Beyond, you know, it's just then is a good follow up for people to take along, and they then follow up and get in touch with you.
Great. So does that make sense, or does that feel like you've got some steps forward to go with?
Yeah, it does. I wonder if Steve, Ann, if you do you have a contact person at the places where you're doing those lunch talks?
Oh, I did it a long time ago. Then I got busy doing my book. Don't have a current person. But
I've
been thinking about all these different connections, and Kaiser is a definitely great place to follow up on. They're in Oakland, you know, there's seminars that they offer.
And I would take a look on LinkedIn to see who you might be connected with to any of the at the corporate level. You can easily do a search on LinkedIn on the company name and then see who might be one or two connections away from you for Kaiser or PG&E or whoever. And that would be a way to find contacts that are warmer than a straight-up cold contact.
Right. Yeah, I've kind of been wondering how to use LinkedIn. We haven't really done much with that, but we're starting to look at, you know, okay, how do you really use that in a effective and non-annoying way?
Rebecca, why don't you join me on LinkedIn?
Okay.
When you have a chance to follow up, and we can exchange some emails about that.
Okay.
I just did something this morning with someone who asked me to make a job referral to someone in Chicago. He's in Chicago, so I did that. You know.
Excellent. Okay.
So it does work.
Great.
When you're doing something like an event, then you broadcast it to your LinkedIn connections who are in the Bay Area, you know, and they let people know. That's one easy way to do it.
Okay.
Great. Okay, well, I think we'll wrap up with Rebecca.
Thank you so much for both of your feedback. I
and
appreciate that.
Just Dr. Toy.
Oh, I didn't know.
Thank
Rebecca
you.
Rebecca and I were so closely aligned in our issues about children and families, so I'm just delighted to meet you. Thank you
That's
so
great.
Much. You're always a great resource in person and great connector.
And I'm sorry
Thank
that
you.
I won't be able to stay through to the
That's
end.
Okay.
I'll have to leave
it's
at
okay.
noon.
We'll catch up later, Rebecca. Good luck
okay.
on it.
Wonderful. Thank you.
You're welcome. So, what's the question?
So, Steve Ann, tell us about you. What's your business? What are you interested in? Who are your clients?
Okay. Well, I'm Dr. Toy, and I'm interested in how parents and children play, what they play with. It starts from baby. The parent is the child's first big toy. And the book that I did is in now the fourth edition. This is the cover. It was designed by a book. The book cover was designed by a toy designer, which is sort of looks like a game. So it just came out in the fourth edition. And so one of the questions I have is how to refresh and expand. You know, I recommended a book to Rebecca, but I also recognize that after you write it, you still have to market it. You still have to get it out to the public. And there are a variety of ways, bookstores, toy stores, and so on. So I've been doing that, but I'd like to expand the book, expand the awareness of the book. And along with it, the website and the services that we've been doing for 25 years. So I'm also training a new person who has a PhD also, who is learning to be the new Dr. Toy and evaluate products. And I'm looking for transition, you know, to finding a company that can take over what we're doing and expand it. The kinds of things Rebecca talked about in affiliation, you realize there's just so much that you can do as a single person. And then if you bring other people in, it takes time also to train and to work on these things. So I also have to be thinking about how to market the book per se, the website, the services that we do, the award program, and all of that. So that hasn't changed. From the time you and I first met, these things have been ongoing, and you've been extremely helpful to me in the past. So when you asked about today, I just jumped in, just fairly happy, because I always learn something new when I connect with you. You're a great marketing person. So that's where I am right now. I'm sort of, the book's just come out. I did a workshop last not a workshop, a presentation last week at Oakland Schools for two high school classes talking about careers in toys. And it was really fun. It was the first time I'd ever done that. And then this morning I did an interview with Reuters about the interface between technology and toys. And last week I talked about that again with CBS on the radio. So I've been doing, you know, bits and pieces of things, but I'd like to sort of see better results this year and actually materialize the things that I've been trying to develop, actually that it would actually happen.
So did you see any bumps after the radio sessions, or have they both aired yet, or not quite?
They did a podcast. I think they sent me the URL of the radio show, and that's up. And I have a lot of, I actually have a YouTube Dr. Toy, so I really have a lot of videos on that YouTube. So what we're going to do today, I assume I can connect it to that YouTube. So I don't know how to do that, but I'd like to know how to do that.
Well, we'll figure it out. We might be figuring it out together, but we'll figure it out.
Well, and like I said, I'm a new challenge.
Books. I think, you know, some of the things actually that you suggested to Rebecca may make sense also for you. For example, you talked about the California Educators of Young Children conference. You know, the things that we typically do, who else influences a buying decision in our category? Well, the preschool teacher can certainly say to the parents, oh, you know, here's a suggestion on a book that you can take a look at that, hopefully I'm okay.
I would actually like to do something, the next step, which is what I've thought about, is making available 10 copies to the school or the class. Mm-hmm. And then the teacher sells them to the parents who want to buy them, and she collects the balance of the money. In other words, it would be a contribution to her class.
Right.
It would make $100 if she sells 10 books or something. So that's what I kind of thought. It would be a fund to buy toys for the classroom.
Oh, that's great.
I was thinking about that, if that would make sense. You know, I'd go in and try something that I hadn't done before. Mm-hmm. Because I've spent a lot of time giving away my time and giving away the information, and now I just have to make it pay off. I need to sell the books, you know, and actually see the results.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought about tying that in, and I just wondered what you thought about that, if that makes sense.
What would the benefit there for you would be more exposure for the book? But it wouldn't have a revenue benefit, because the revenue benefit would go to the...
If I sold 10 copies and they were $10 each, that they bought them, right? The teacher bought them.
Oh, I see.
And then she sells them for 20.
Gotcha.
So she gets 10, she gets $100.
Now I understand. I missed that part in that conversation.
I would be able to at least get my basic cost covered.
Right.
And
right.
That cost, and then she would make the money. And that money could be as a fundraiser for the classrooms buying some new toys.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought might be a win-win situation for everybody.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. And I know that the range of infanthood all the way up much older than that.
Right.
I think that sounds like a good idea. I think also in terms of the Bay Area and connections, I know you've been connected with Goldie Blocks in various ways, and they're growing.
Yes.
So I'm wondering about maybe some partnership with them as well, maybe something similar to what you just described. They have... You can package a book with it, with some of their toys, or a coupon for a book, or something with the book. In addition to the...
In that regard, you know, I try to remain neutral. I give assistance to all the toy companies in the Bay Area and across the country and around the world. I help, because when Goldie Block started, she was just starting out. She asked my advice like I ask your advice. We give it back to each other. But if I made that offer to them, I would have to make it to all the other companies as well. That would be what I would like to do.
Well,
To make it to everybody.
Yeah.
Right?
I just wanted to share one resource with you, Steve-Ann.
Yes.
We've started to look at this program, and maybe you're familiar with it, by Alex Carroll, Carroll, about how to get on the radio, you know, to many, many programs. And he does this whole program about how to get on the radio. So you're on a ton of radio stations, and he wrote a book on how to beat speeding tickets. And he said, you know, he's just sold, you know, a gazillion copies of this book because of being on the radio. And you know, your topic lends itself very, very well, especially around gift-giving seasons, to that kind of thing. So look
is
him up.
He can't, online?
I'm sure he is. Kirsten is the one who is sort of backing me up with all this marketing, so she would know the specifics. But I'm sure if you just research that, it's a radio marketing program. But I see a cup of coffee in our future, so we can chat about it over coffee.
Okay. I promise to bring some toys along.
Fantastic. Well, thank you. I'm going to have to say goodbye now. Thank you so much for including me in this.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us.
Have a playful day.
Thank you, and you.
So
well, that was helpful.
That was great.
Yeah, very good. You know, I enjoy having the radio experiences. I've done a ton of radio shows all over the country. Mm-hmm. But I never know after the show if it has any impact. You know, I don't see an uptick in sales of the book because the book may not be in that North Dakota bookstore. The radio, you know, the radio show in North Dakota gets in touch with me, but I don't know that mm-hmm. the book is going to sell there. I've done that a lot, and it's been interesting meeting a lot of people on the radio, but I can't confirm the results.
So, do you see any upticks on Amazon or other outlets that might be cross?
I haven't been able to measure that. I haven't seen it. I haven't seen that necessarily connect.
Okay.
So I'm not sure. I know I have to mm-hmm. do more measuring of these impact of these things. Mm-hmm. But last week I didn't see necessarily more sales in CBS.
Right.
The book sometimes gets mentioned and so on, but it's like starting all over again. I've done this now. This is the fourth edition, mm-hmm. and it is better and bigger, and you know, I've spent a lot of time putting it together. Mm-hmm. But see, the book is like anything you're trying to market. A book is just an example. Services, a product, your expertise, whatever it is, it's a similar sort of situation, no matter what it is that you've got available to sell. And learning how to market it properly to the right audience is really key to making mm-hmm. this all work. So I'm always trying to learn.
And I think that there are a couple of audiences that make sense, as we've talked about. There's the parents themselves.
Right.
There's the teachers.
Right.
There might be the grandparents.
Yes.
And that, you know, I'm wondering, I haven't looked at your YouTube channel, but I'm curious about what kinds of things you put on there. I'm almost thinking that showing a demo of how you test a toy and what, you know, your whole process so that people get that the book is a distillation of so much research. So I'm not sure, what do you have on the YouTube channel?
It's a variety of interviews, mm-hmm. Themes of play. I did 10 interviews with a company called Askimo, which is something you might like to know about, too. They're based in Israel, and they do interviews with specialists. And they did the interview as we're doing it, but they mm-hmm. taped it, and then they put it on their site. But I haven't figured out how to put those interviews on the YouTube channel yet. There are 10
okay.
interviews with them. So there's another technical thing. I've written to them to ask, but I haven't heard back.
Okay.
Each thing that you do has somehow a learning curve. And it's not so simple to exactly move it forward.
Right.
So we have a lot of interviews on the YouTube channel. It will be interesting. I'd love to have your feedback when you have time.
Yeah, I'll take a look.
Look at it and tell me what you think works and doesn't work.
Well, what I'm hearing is that the real power of what you do is thinking about how the kid's going to interact with the toy and the developmental stage of where they are. And so if there's a way to really make it fun on the video, which I think if it's an interview, it's not going to have that sensibility to it. It's as much as I love doing this, it's not like we're playing with the toy right now and talking about this is really tactile, it's got this many colors, you can talk to the kid about all the colors, you can talk to the kid about the textures and the sounds and whatever else.
Right.
I think if you did that with a few toys at each of the age levels, people would really appreciate that they were getting a taste of the depth of what you've got in the book.
Right.
And I think that's got some oomph behind it.
I think that is a really good idea, and I think that that would be very useful to do. Do I need a kid to do it with?
Ideally, it would be great if you had a kid to do it with, but I think, I mean, I don't know, how do you do the testing that you do? Yeah. Are there kids involved or not?
I think that it might be better not to include a particular child, but just show a particular product and how to think about it. I probably can get that done without a lot of effort. Doing it with a child is always unpredictable because you never know how they're going to exactly react.
Exactly. So
talking about things and picking some examples from baby onward would be very good.
Yeah, I think that would be great.
I've done it, but I never recorded it.
Yeah. So I think that would really help people understand that it's, you know, got this other depth and energy to it. In addition to having your background and your expertise and degree, but to really make it come alive.
Yes, I agree. I think figure out a time to do that. That would be really good to try.
And then I can see, you know, maybe you and Rebecah partnering on great toys for spirited kids to help them do this or that or the other thing, or high sensory toys that help kids, or low sensory toys, depending on the kid, that are a better fit. So thinking about both the age, but then also any specifics of the child that make it a better match.
Right.
Because that's a term someone might, we want to be thinking about. What will someone do the Google search on? Will they do it on toy for 6-month-olds?
Toys that calm kids down and keep them focused.
Sensory.
You know, that kind
exactly.
of thing. I agree with you very much. No, it's a really good suggestion. And I'll tell you, unexpectedly, because I didn't know Rebecca was dealing with children. I thought it was accounting.
I did too.
So it's a perfect connection.
Yeah,
thank you. It's been really, really helpful to do this.
Good.
And I'd like to recommend that you spend some time every day playing too.
Oh, thank you. Well, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Have a great day.
You too.
Bye-bye.